Good evening and welcome to Midsummer Norton Methodist Church. Normally we would be here in the church building with it full of people coming to sing our favourite carols and to listen to this age-old story of Jesus' birth. But tonight, because of the restrictions, we're not able to do that. And so welcome to those of you who are watching this online in your own homes. And to those of you who will be listening to this on the audio CDs, we share together, even though we are separate, we share together in worshipping God. And as we are in our own homes, we're able to sing the wonderful carols that we wouldn't be able to do if we were in the building. And so we're grateful to God for this incredible technology which has come into its own this year to enable us to be together as one. Just a few things to say by way of practicalities. If you have a candle in your home, I invite you in a moment to pause the recording and go and get it ready for later on in the service, where if we were in the building, we would all hold a lit candle. So if you've got a candle, you might like to pause the recording now and go and find that. And we want to thank everybody who is involved in tonight's service. You'll see that we have a singing group, our organist, Mark, on all the technology, who has enabled all this to happen so that we can still hold a carol service this year. This week, from Monday to Thursday, our church building will be open for private prayer. And there'll be prayer stations around the building where people can come and reflect on the Christmas story. So we're open Monday to Thursday, 10 a.m. until 1 p.m. And then on Monday night from 6 till 8, especially for those of you who work during the day, you are welcome to come and spend some time safely. We'll have all the things that need to be in place for you to spend some time in prayer with God. And then just to mention Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, on Christmas Eve at 6 p.m. we shall be holding our Christingle service, sadly again not in the building, but we shall be online live. So if you've got an orange in your home, do come with that. And then if you're able to pop into church over these next few days to get a bag of bits for the rest of the Christingle, we can make our Christingle as the service progresses in that. Then Christmas Eve to 11:30, again we won't be in the building sadly, but we shall have a short service, a reflective service to bring us into Christmas Day, the birth of Jesus. And then on Christmas Day at 10:30 a.m. we shall be holding a service here in the building. We need to ask you to book for that on the church phone number, which you'll find on the website. But we shall also be broadcasting that live on our Facebook page so that as many people as possible can join in with that. Those are the notices. And so we share together in this carol service. And I begin with the traditional bidding. Beloved in Christ, at this Christmas time, let it be our care and delight to hear again the message of the angels, and in heart and mind go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which is come to pass, and the babe lying in a manger. Therefore let us read and mark in Holy Scripture the tale of the loving purposes of God from the first days of our disobedience until the glorious redemption brought us by this Holy Child. We pray for the needs of the whole world, for peace on earth and goodwill amongst all his people. For unity within the church he came to build, and especially in this church and our local churches. And because this would rejoice his heart, let us remember in his name the poor and helpless, the cold, the hungry and the oppressed, the sick and those that mourn, the lonely and the unloved, the aged and all children, all those who know not the Lord Jesus, or who love him not, or who by sin have grieved his heart of love. Lastly, let us remember before God all those who rejoice with us, but upon another shore, adding a greater light, that multitude which no one can number, whose hope was in the Word made flesh, and with whom, in the Lord Jesus Christ, we are one forever. And so we go through our carol service unannounced with our hymns and readings. To show us your love for each and every one of us. And as we share together and hear and sing this oh familiar story, we pray that in that familiarity you would come to us afresh, show us something maybe we haven't seen before in the story. May it come alive for us tonight as we share together. But most of all, we give you thanks and praise that you acted decisively. You saw humanity in its need and in its sin. And you sent Jesus, the one who saves, to redeem us and to offer us new life and a new start. And we find that offer of new life and a new start in that cradle in Bethlehem, in that baby who was to grow up and become a man, who was to die on that cross for each and every one of us, but then was raised to life that we might know forgiveness of sin, we might know eternal life. And so we pray and we give you thanks for your purposes which have been there from the very beginning. So lead us and guide us as we share together tonight. And although we are not able to be in the same building, unite us in your love, in faith, and in hope. For we pray these things in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. We say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." And he said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree which I commanded you not to eat?" The man said, "The woman you put here with me, she gave me some fruit from the tree, and I ate it." Then the Lord God said to the woman, "What is this you have done?" The woman said, "The snake deceived me, and I ate." So the Lord God said to the snake, "Because you have done this, cursed are you above all livestock and all wild animals. You will crawl on your belly, and you will eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel."
light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from old, from ancient times. Therefore, Israel will be abandoned until the time when she who is in labor bears a son, and the rest of his brothers return to join the Israelites. He will stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they will live securely, for then his greatness will reach to the ends of the earth.
Thank you.
to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favoured, the Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favour with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she, who was said to be unable to conceive, is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her.
Together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law, and yet he did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us." When Joseph woke up, he did what the angels of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus.
In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them.
Oh,
flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Saviour has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favour rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
Thank you.
He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet, to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
I don't need to tell you that this year has not been the year we hoped it would be. The COVID-19 virus that we started the year hearing about on the news, about something which was happening in another part of the world, became a pandemic, and in March was affecting us all as we went into lockdown and we still live under restrictions. This Christmas will not be the sort of Christmas we would have hoped to have with family or friends, or by going away on holiday. On a lighter note, I hear some cheers from some of you. No trailing around the endless relatives or having to do the dutiful things that happen every Christmas. But on a more serious note, I am aware from some of our church members that the restrictions mean they cannot be with family this Christmas, except through telephone calls or computer screens for those of you who have them. So what does this Christmas story say to us in COVID-19 2020? Well, first of all, we need to defluff the story of all the sentimental aspects that have been built up around it. The carol Away in a Manger may be many people's favourite, but it does lean tremendously towards the sentimental picture of Christmas, especially when children are singing it. Let's look at the reality of the Christmas story. As a background, the Old Testament readings we heard tonight speak of the origins of humanity and how sin came into the world, which spread in a similar way a virus spreads in a pandemic, by touch, by thoughts, by disobedience. Nevertheless, we heard the prophets of Isaiah and Micah looking forward to a day when there would be a cure for this sin. And the cure would come in the form of a child born to us. 700 years later or so, the people are living in an occupied territory, and the occupiers are the Romans, harsh rulers who gave orders which affected how the people were able to live. For them, our COVID-19 restrictions would have been merciful in comparison. Luke tells us that Caesar had decreed a census. This wasn't a request, it was an order that had to be done. Mary and Joseph had both had godly angelic visitations to tell them that they were to be used by God for the purposes he had planned. God's pandemic plan as an antidote to sin. Our Matthew reading recalls that they were told that the child born should be called Jesus. And we're told what that means. For he will save his people from their sin. Matthew, in that same passage we heard, also tells us that he was to be called Emmanuel, God with us. And so a child is born, Jesus, into a world under restrictions and government legislation as God's remedy for the pandemic of the disease of sin. But we also remember that he comes to us as Emmanuel, God with us. Or as John puts it in that reading we heard, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of truth and grace. This is the good news of the Christmas message, that no matter what restrictions we live under, God still comes to us and we can know his peace and his love in our hearts. And he can save us from our sins that have displayed themselves in our pandemic, in the selfishness of panic buying at the expense of others, in the disregard for guidelines meant to keep us all safe and at the expense of other people's lives. So this Christmas will be different for all of us. And it can be different for all of us as we receive the greatest gift of Emmanuel, God with us. And as we receive him into our heart by prayer, we can know that same joy that Mary and Joseph experienced, and the shepherds who hastened on their way as they opened their hearts to Emmanuel, God with us. Tonight, an opportunity for you to open your heart to God and receive him as Emmanuel, God with us. Even in these strangest times, we can still welcome him into our hearts and we can rejoice. We're going to watch a short video clip which is on that very theme to help us reflect.
Just isn't the Christmas we ordered. It's not what we expect. We want our winter wonderland.
Our party plans are wrecked.
But don't we know we're not the first to have a world turned upside down? Joseph and Mary must have felt this way, out of place in an unknown town. To be having a baby in such a random way. They're all stressed out in Bethlehem, just want a normal day. Still, even in the strangest times, there's good news to be found. What are the things that we're thankful for when we stop and we look around?
Strangest times.
Christmas time.
There's good news to be found,
even in the strangest time.
There's good news to be found,
even in the strangest time.
There's good news to be found.
Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel will come to you. Rejoice, rejoice.
Welcome God into our lives as Emmanuel. We can experience it as if darkness disappears and light comes onto the scene. No matter what is going on in our world, no matter how dark it seems, we can know, as our last carol will enable us to sing, the light and life to all he brings. And all of that begins with a baby born in Bethlehem, Jesus. As our last carol we have just sung says in its last verse, sacred infant, holy child, tender love so pure and mild, comes from heaven's highest bliss down to such a world as this. And so as he brings light into our lives, I invite you to take the candle which you may have found in your homes earlier on this evening. Normally in our carol service we would be handing candles out and everybody would light their candles, an impressive way in which the light comes into the darkness. And I invite you in a moment to light your candle. And if you're not able to do this now, maybe after you watch this recording, that you would be able to share in this. And on behalf of all of us who are watching this tonight, I'm going to light this main candle here as a sign for all of us that life and light to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Christ comes as the light of the world, to be your Emmanuel, turning your darkness into light. That is the true meaning and reality of Christmas, as we receive the gift of Jesus, the light of the world, into our lives. Let us pray. God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you come to us as Emmanuel, God with us. Thank you that you have given us Jesus, the one who will save us from the pandemic of sin, and that you give us a new start. So come to us, Lord Jesus, this hour, that we may receive you, the greatest gift we can ever receive. And as we receive you, we can know that joy, the joy of the angels, the joy of the shepherds, that treasured heart which Mary experienced. We can go on our way rejoicing. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And so we conclude with that carol, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. May he who by his incarnation gathered into one things earthly and heavenly fill your lives with his light and joy and peace. And the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with you all.